Hello, good evening, and welcome to Newsnight. In this edition, family of slain social media activists demand police arrest the actual perpetrators of his killing as they reject reports that brother of the deceased is involved in the late Kaka's murder.
And what they are saying is that they are swearing by the Quran that Idi, who is a brother to the deceased Kaka, cannot be the one who murdered his own brother.
Also, more condemnations tonight of the Ejua killings as civil society, political parties and Christian community question the shoot-to-kill approach of the military deployed to quell the protest, saying it is criminal and must be investigated. We'll hear from them. Also tonight, police anti-robbery task force launched frontal attack on recent spate of armed robberies, retrieving about 3,000 ammunitions, several guns, other weapons in the latest raid in the eastern region.
One AK-47 assault rifle, one M16 rifle, one pump action gun, 2,882 rounds of ammunition, 840 rounds of M16 ammunition, 7 machetes, clubs, sword, knives, crowbar, military camouflage uniform.
We'll hear from the police live on this. Jomoro MP challenges Sekendi High Court order to produce certificate of her renounced Ivorian citizenship. We have more as the Western Region NDC shoots down assertions that the MP does not have the renunciation certificate, reason for her appeal.
And we have evidence that she has already renounced a document filed even before the NDC primary.
And in business, Finance Minister Ken Ofori-Atta describes Ghana's removal from FATF's list of money laundering countries as economic confidence booster.
And later in our Clean Ghana campaign, AMA official storm landing market in Accra and order meat sellers to immediately undergo medical screening as it emerges that over 350 of them have no medical certificates.
From today, I'm telling you, yeah. I'm assuring you.
Because they,
after today's exercise,
exactly,
all of you, we are going to subject you to screening. And we are going to ensure that this, your roof, you yourself, provide roofing sheet and roof the place.
We have that and more in tonight's edition of Newsnight. You can join us with your thoughts and comments. It's via WhatsApp 055-1111997. You're also watching us live on Facebook. You can leave your comments there as well. I am Emefa Apawu.
And my name is Evans Mensah.
Thanks so much for your company once again. Tonight, family of the slain social media activist Ibrahim Mohammed, popularly known as Kaka, is demanding the police to bring to book the actual perpetrators of his murder.
Well, wife of the late Kaka and her children have been swearing by the Quran that a brother to the deceased, arrested by the police, knows nothing about his death. In a teary, emotional moment, we join News Sada Hudu and her children recounted how they found their father and husband lying in a pool of blood.
Now, these events unfolded when the MP for Ejua Secretary Dumasi Bawa Brahima visited families affected by the unrest in the Ashanti regional town these past days. Love FM's Irasa Sasaridongo has more.
The Ejua Municipal Police Commander, DSP Philip Hammond, says three people have been arrested in connection with the death of Ibrahim Mohammed, popularly known as Kaka, a social media advocate.
So far, we have picked three people under investigation. We just picked one in addition to the previous two, making three a while ago, and we are investigating them.
Yawa Quran!
We were greeted by a wailing family of Kaka holding copies of the Holy Quran, protesting that Idi, a brother to the deceased arrested in connection with his murder, is innocent.
What these women are saying is that the police say they've arrested three people. One of them is a brother to the deceased, and his name is Idi, and he lives in this room. And what they are saying is that they are swearing by the Quran that Idi, who is a brother to the deceased, Kaka, cannot be the one who murdered his own brother. So you can see the children in tears at this moment. And it is an emotional moment for them. Let me find out from the children why they are crying at the moment. So the youngest of them is 2.5, and the oldest is how old?
15.
And these are the children left behind by Kaka, whose death has brought in this lot of protest on the streets of Edra. The MP for Edra, Bawa Brahma, also paid a visit to families of the two young men shot by the military during the protest. This is the family home of Muntala Muhammad, 26, a businessman who deals in motorbikes. Killed by the military, his grandfather is this chief, Alhaji Umar Al-Hassan, the Dagumba chief of Edra. He is calling for calm. At the house of Abdul Nasir Yusuf, the second person slain by the military, the MP called for calm. Bawa Brahma repeated calls on government to desist from the use of the military for the management of internal security of the country.
So I am by this medium calling on the various security agencies, especially the National Security Minister, the Defense Minister, and the Interior Minister, to put a stop to the wanton deployment of military personnel in the internal arrangement of this country, or the internal security management of this country, because everywhere that the military has gone, they have acted unprofessionally and it has led of lies. I condemn in no uncertain terms the killings of these two innocent souls in my constituency, and I demand the people of Edra City demand that a probe be instituted, and the soldier who knelt down and aimed and shot into the crowd be brought to book, especially the military. The one who was in charge of the military in Nigeria should also be brought to book, because we cannot use our taxpayers' money to buy uniforms for you, pay you, buy guns, and you use them to kill us.
Reporting for Joy News, Erastus Asaredonko, Edra, Ashanti Region.
Well, so there have been, as we know, fast-moving reactions to the events of yesterday and, of course, the killing of Kaka. We know that the president has directed a public inquiry into this, but we are getting other faith-based groups also adding their voice and condemning the actions of the parties yesterday, particularly the military and the police. So we have the National Catholic Secretariat, Office of the President, has issued a statement on this, and of course they condemn in on certain terms the killing of Kaka, the social media activist. They also, of course, are disgusted by the killing of the two people in the protest yesterday. They were particularly unhappy with the conduct of the military, and they say the question, for example, how can one justify the action of the military man seen in the viral video aiming and shooting at unprotected and unnamed civilians in an attempt to stop the demonstration? That's a question, and that video is one that we've circulated quite widely because our reporters captured it. It said this act is not only condemnable but criminal and must be investigated and the perpetrators duly punished. It said this must be done with the urgency it deserves because citizens are gradually losing trust in the ability of our security agencies to handle such cases effectively and competently.
So we've been joined on the phone by Most Reverend Philip Name. He's Metropolitan Archbishop of Tamale and President of the Ghana Catholic Bishops Conference. We are grateful for your time here on Newsnight. So we've heard about the condemnation. You are the latest group to wade into this particular issue, condemning it to a large extent. But what really would you want seen done in this particular issue?
Well, we would have been happy if the security minister had come up to make a statement on this issue. And the silence of the security minister is very worrying that, as people are saying, if soldiers are brought in and they act to act so unprofessionally, we lose trust. We just lose trust in the ability of our own security to protect us. And I think that is what is really very worrying for all of us.
Well, whilst we wait for the security minister, I'm sure you're talking about the national security minister. We've heard from the interior minister, for instance, on this issue. Today, government also condemned it, asking the security officials to expedite investigations into this. So what really would you want to hear the security minister say about this?
Well, to condemn his own people, the national security, we expected them to make a statement to really confirm the unprofessional behavior of those soldiers, as we have stated in our statement, who kind of took a posture of aiming and actually shooting and killing innocent civilians. I think this is not anything that we expect from our army.
Are you hopeful that anyone will be punished at the end of it all?
That is what we expect. We expect that soldiers who so behave should be brought to book. And we don't expect anything actually less than dismissing soldiers who so behave. That is the punishment we expect. But not just any kind of punishment, but just dismissing them from the security forces, because that is not what they were trained to do.
Well, in the last few minutes also, we've heard the president direct the minister in charge to launch a public inquiry into this. Would you say that will be the way to go?
This is not the way to go, because we are used to such kind of directives which don't yield anything. We need a kind of sanction or punishment which will intimidate and be a lesson to all others. But just to make such a loose directive is not enough.
We'll leave it here. Thank you very much for your time. Most Reverend Philip Name, the president of the Catholic Bishops Conference, the latest to issue a statement. But it appears that they've been beating also by the National Peace Council. There's another statement from them as well.
Yeah, I mean, they also condemn the incidents that led to the loss of lives. They also noting with appreciation that this is quoting them, the president's directive for a public inquiry to be instituted into this. And they also expressing their condolences to the affected families and encouraging all persons in the community to keep calm and allow investigations to take place. They also want full investigation into the matter, but also asking the media to be circumspect and exercise maximum restraint in our coverage of this unfolding matter. They are not the only a organization condemning this. We've heard from the
Occupy Ghana
making same pronouncements about militarization of keeping the peace in Ghana and condemning that. But also, the former president has also been saying something on this.
And he's urgently calling on President Akufo-Addo to initiate an immediate de-escalation of the situation in Nigeria. For him, there must be a very thorough investigation of both the murder of the youth activist and the security's rules of engagement, which resulted in the shooting to death of the two others. His party have also issued a statement in that regard, appealing for calm in Ijura and a call on the security agencies to be measured in the way and manner in which they handle citizens who are exercising their constitutionally guaranteed right to demonstrate, to protect and the lives of innocent citizens.
Well, the Progressive People's Party also is asking the Speaker of Parliament to invite the Minister for Interior and Defence to answer urgent questions regarding what happened, both the killing of Kaka and the reported deaths of two people, of course, in that particular area. We know that today the Kojo Opon-Krumah, who is Information Minister, has asked the security agencies to speed up investigations to ensure perpetrators are brought to book.
The suspected murder of Ibrahim Mohammed, popularly called Kaka,
and the subsequent death of two others, coupled with the injury of at least three more persons during youth protests after his burial, are terribly, terribly unfortunate and condemnable. We commiserate with the victims, the families, the loved ones, and the people of Ijura. Our security agencies should be quick and clinical in getting to the bottom of this and other unresolved crimes. Now, while we understand that police investigations sometimes take a while, it does not instill confidence in the population if such acts go unresolved and unpunished quickly. So the police need to get to the bottom of this, and justice must be done. Also, a credible investigation needs to be conducted into the crowd routing and crowd control incident of the 29th of June. This is necessary to bring clarity to the sequence of events and to ensure that if any persons acted inappropriately, those persons are punished. We've also read and seen videos, I think this morning, from youth groups and family members who are admonishing politicians and other social groups who want to be opportunistic about this very sad incident to back off. And I think we can all agree with them. Let's deal with the purely criminal matter and get justice done for Kaka.
So that is the Information Minister. Well, as you know now, the President has directed the Interior Minister to institute a public inquiry within 10 days. He has up until the 9th of July to finish that work and hand a report back to the President. Well, today, the Interior Minister, Ambrose Dere, has appeared before the Public Accounts Committee and was asked questions relating to the conduct of the police in managing your protests.
Minister, before you come in, I would just love, I asked a specific question about a manual. So you have the manual. And with your explanation, and with what we have seen, what our constituents have told us, it appears that a Ghana police force always starts with maximum lethal force in quelling any demonstration. And don't you have a responsibility as the police service to be able to contain the individuals that you point out in the crowd may have offensive weapons, to contain them and handle that threat, than to expose the entire crowd to the use of maximum lethal force? Because when you use the US example, they've got the verbal warning that you speak about, they've got the physical restraint, then they've got what they call minimal lethal force before the use of maximum lethal force. Our police service in Ghana appears to always start or lead with lethal police, lethal force.
Honorable Chairman, with the greatest respect, I will not refer to the U.S. for any good examples of dealing with suspects. I will not. I cannot breathe in that thing. Ghana police should not get to that level. Please.
Minister, our member for Ijura is not here today because of actions that were taken in Ijura yesterday. And
please,
so if you want to talk about policing,
please.
We saw police officers on display at Ijura yesterday, so be minded by that.
Please, Honorable Chairman, I thought that we were asking questions to get explanations. And let me talk. The IGP would be addressing the issues of Ijura after this. And I think that we should allow that. Let me say that I, at various levels, as a citizen, as a lawyer, we have had problems over the years. George, my nephew, you may listen. We've had problems over the years. We've been part of demonstrations. As students, we've suffered a lot of, beatings and all that. It is a thing that I am passionate about checking. The right to demonstrate in Ghana must be respected, and government is committed to doing that. No question. Listen well, listen well. There's a misunderstanding. Nobody asked anybody to apply to the police for a permit to demonstrate. No. You give notice to the police because the government has a duty to protect you during the demonstration. So when you go to them, what you'll be discussing are the routes, and then we provide police to shepherd you. One of the reasons being that when the police are with you, they are able to detect some of these infiltrators who are not most of the time under the control of the main organizers. But we've had a problem. The problem has always been that when it happens, the investigations about who did what becomes a problem. Honorable Chairman, if I may. Honorable Chairman, I think this is a serious matter. We have a proposal, even before, while we deal with this, that we need a piece of equipment that is very, very critical. Body cams. Body cams. We need them to put them on our security personnel. It will give us a video of what transpired at the critical times for us to be able to tell who exactly did what. The standard police procedures are in place. But Mr. Chairman, Honorable Chairman, let me sound that we are, you see, honorable members, these are, you know. Honorable,
shall we listen to the minister?
You see, please, we are in very critical conditions, seriously. Look, we shouldn't rule out that extremists can use our demonstrations to cause problems. We shouldn't rule that out at all. And it's not going to benefit any of us here. If a police is found to have dealt unfairly with any person, I and the rest of us should be. Who are they demonstrating? They are our children. The youth of this country, they are our children. So who is going to come out of that? But sometimes we need to educate ourselves about what the issues are. Look, he would address Ejra, and at the end of the day, you get.
That's the Interior Minister, Ambrose Derry, in that interaction with the member of the Public Accounts Committee, Sam George.
You're still listening to Newsnight. It's on Joy 99.7 FM. Shortly, we'll be sharing with you some of your thoughts on the unfolding story in Ejra. And, of course, there's one more person who's currently receiving treatment in Konfanoche Teaching Hospital after transfer there, 055-111-1997. Let's stay with issues surrounding security, because 3,745 rounds of various ammunitions, 5 sophisticated guns, machetes, swords, and other dangerous weapons, all at one location at Ntoso in the Eastern Region, have been seized by the police.
Now, these were retrieved by the anti-armed robbery task force of the Ghana Police Service following a frontal attack on recent spate of armed robberies in parts of the country. In the process, a notorious armed robber, Joseph Ampa, who has been on the wanted list of the police, was also picked up. He's alleged to have established 5 robbery gangs and provided arms to his recruits. We can listen to the director of police SCID, COP Ken Yeboah, briefing the public earlier today.
He took part in 3 different robberies on 27th March, 19th May 2021, and then on the 26th of May 2021, where they took bars of gold and unspecified amounts of money, and in the process shot the victim many times and took away his vehicle, which was later abandoned at Akoko Junction on the Bunsu Apawu Road. He is alleged to have established 5 robbery gangs, different ones, 5, and have provided them with arms and ammunition to attack, rob, and share the booty. He and his gang have attacked and robbed victims at gunpoint, and in some instances have killed their victims. They have also snatched vehicles from their victims.
That's the head of CID, COP Kenya Bwa, at that press briefing earlier. Let's bring in the National Director of Operations for the Ghana Police Service, ACP Kwesi Ahenga. No, we're grateful for your time here on Newsnight. So let's first draw a distinction between the anti-armed robbery squad that we know was set up in 1981 and the recent anti-armed robbery task force that was launched a few days ago.
Yeah, thank you very much, my sister. Yeah, the difference is that, you know, of late, there have been a series of armed robbery cases in the country. So the police administration, led by the Inspector General of Police, decided to form a special task force to deal with armed robbery cases in the country. Our basic task is to look for armed robbers, arrest them, and get them prosecuted. So basically, that's the difference. This is solely basically for robbery cases and other violent crimes.
But how different are the strategies being adopted to combat robberies and crimes in the country? Because anytime we say that there's an increase in cases of armed robberies, the police may disagree. But let's talk about the strategies that you're adopting, which is different from what we used to do.
Yeah, the strategies we are adopting now is that we have zoned the metropolis into seven sectors. You can talk about Weja, Nima, of Amco, Abokuvi, and Mensah. You see, these are rules. We considered the entry and then the exit points of the metropolis and then formed this sub-test. So what we are doing now is that we have teams in each of the sectors being supervised by senior police officers. Apart from that, you see, their basic job is to stop and search all vehicles, motorbikes, people with suspicious characters. They have to stop them and then search them to see if they can find any offensive weapons. Apart from that, we also have our motorbikes, normally we call the rovers. They have also been placed at the various intersections and then the vantage points. Now, what we are doing is that we are no longer doing patrols. We have placed our patrol teams all over the various intersections. They have to be there to monitor activities. When it becomes necessary that they move in, then they will move in to go and attend to situation, and then they come back to their base. Then apart from that too, we have the K-9 units, that is the dogs. We are also using them to support our operation, because some of these dogs, they will be able to detect when there's a weapon with somebody or when there's a narcotic or drugs with somebody, they will be able to detect it. So we are also using them in our operations. So far, these are some of the strategies that we are using to deal with the robbery situation in the countries. Apart from that, we also have the intelligence units. We have personnel all over. They are all over in the field, gathering intelligence for us to act appropriately to deal with the criminals.
Well, so in the past, most of these robberies were targeted to residents, amongst others. But now, in the past few days, for instance, the number of robberies we've recorded, broad daylight robberies, they're targeting vulnerable areas. We've heard about the bullion van attacks, amongst others. Are you averting your mind to this particular trending situation?
Yeah, that is why now we have police personnel all over the vantage points. Now, police, our visibility is in town. I don't know whether you've been going to town recently. You see that everywhere that you park, we have police personnel.
I don't know which part of town I go to, but at least I've heard my colleagues talk about the elite areas. Yes, they see police visibility, but for us, yes. Odoko and the other areas, I have not seen police visibility as you talk area. About. Yes.
Yeah, we have Odoko is along the Weja route. So we have things there. But now what they do is that they will be at a particular location. They will wait for some time, and then they'll move to another point. This is what we've been doing. We are praying. Then we also have praying crew personnel who are also in town monitoring activities and then gathering intelligence for us to move on. So we are in town.
Okay, if you say so. But the bullion van robberies, for instance, are there specific measures that you're putting in place as a result of the cases that we've recorded?
So far, what we are doing is that we've asked our commanders to escort the bullion van. Instead of sitting in the bullion van, now they are not going to do that. We have an escort vehicle, and they will escort the bullion van. And the personnel should not be more than, they should not be less than three. And they also have to put on their body armor and then the helmet. So that is the directive that has been given by the chief of police.
At whose cost, though? The
Come
banks?
Again?
At whose cost? The banks or
yeah,
just the
banks.
Police taking it up?
The banks will have to take it, take care of that.
Okay, but we know also that there was a negotiation between the banks and then the police. Of course, there was a deadline that was given for them to procure armored vans for this purpose. Has that been reviewed, or we are sticking with the deadline that you gave
now,
them?
For now, this is what we are doing. The chief of police has given the deadline. So let's wait to the deadline and then see what happens.
So the deadline is still in June?
The
deadline is supposed to be tomorrow. Are we still sticking with that deadline, or you say that that has been reviewed?
Yeah, for now, let's leave it like that.
How do we leave it like that for now?
No, because it's not yet first. Today is 30th. So when we get to first, if it becomes necessary that we have to rebuild it, we'll do that.
So should we expect that maybe starting tomorrow, we should, all the banks would have their bullion vans ready, or the police is giving them some time to deal with that?
That is what I'm saying. Let's wait. For now, this is the strategy that we have adopted, and we are using it. So tomorrow, I'm sure that the top management will meet on that. And whatever decisions that will come out of it, we'll carry it along.
We'll be expecting that. But in all, overall, mm-hmm. the police can give an assurance that when it comes to armed robbery, increasing speed of crime, the police is on top of the situation.
Yeah, we are on top of our job. Because now we have many of our personnel in town. And we are on top of our job. And I want to make this appeal. You see, people who live in the communities, they know the job that people do. If somebody is an armed robber, they know it. So they want to appeal to them to volunteer information to police, because it's very, very important. Most of the job that we are doing tries on information. So when they give us information on the criminals, that will also enhance our work and then the performance of the job that we are doing. So I want to appeal to them that they should give us credible information. And when that is given to us, we assure them that we'll fight and fight till the last criminal is captured or eliminated, so that they'll be free to go about their lawful activities in the country.
We are grateful for your time. That's the National Director of Operations for the Ghana Police Service, ACP Kwesi Aheng Anoh.
Well, still ahead, NDC General Member of Parliament challenges Sekendi High Court's order to produce certificate of renounced Ivorian citizenship. More as the Western Region NDC shoots down assertions that the MP does not have the renunciation certificate, reason for her appeal.
And we have evidence that she has already renounced a document filed even before the NDC primary.
Well, we have details of that. George is here with business. Hello, George.
Hi, Evans. And the Finance Minister, Ken Ofori-Atta, describes Ghana's removal from the Financial Action Task Force list of money laundering countries as an economic booster in the economy. And Securities and Exchange Commission moves to check advertising of non-licensed investment firms in the country. The business news on Newsnight is brought to you by MTN Business. Welcome to the new world of business. Kingdom Books and Stationery, your number one stop shop for all your office essentials, and Allianz Live.
Business, no, a bit news to say. So the projections from the first quarter show a higher total gross profit for the fiscal year.
A bit me a casa say you.
Nana, who's not land you? He did a port right here.
A bit me a say.
Here are your items. Thank you for coming.
A bit me a casa say you.
Yes, 2 for 10 cedi. Me a no 10 cedi. 2 for 10 cedi.
Well, that you know, a bit me a coordinate. And for who business are we? The beer who beer. You have to have a wow. MTN Business Solutions. Meant to enable your business stay ahead of the park. Trisha Yen, I will mtn.business.gh at mtn.com. Fre, and now what's up here? I will 0244-308-111. MTN, everywhere you go.
Son, we are so proud of you for setting up this hospital. I really love those hospital beds and waiting chairs. By the way, did you import them?
No, Dad, I didn't. I actually got them from Kindle Books and Stationery right here in Ghana.
Wow. We also bought our office supplies, safes, executive desks and chairs from Kingdom, and they gave us expert advice on how to set up our office.
Guys, that makes three of us. I also got our sofa and bedroom sets, plus our dining hall furniture for our new home from Kingdom.
Wow, Mom, that makes four of us. I usually get my stationery items from Kingdom, and my teacher also mentioned that our classroom furniture was provided by Kingdom.
So there you have it. Whenever you're thinking about setting up an office or acquiring furniture for your home, etc., Kingdom Books and Stationery should be your first point of call. With over 40 years experience in the industry, we stock and supply a wide variety of globally sourced office and home furniture, stationery and equipment. Visit our head office, Osu Akwaje, or our office near the Osu Stadium. We're also in Tema Community 1, opposite Olam SHF, Kumase KNUSD Campus, UCC Cape Coast, and now at the Marina Mall, Airport City. Or call us 0302-764101, 764209, or 762792. Visit our website, www.kingdomgh.com.
Allianz Insurance since 1890. At Allianz Life Ghana, we have a wide range of life insurance packages to suit all pockets, from individuals, groups, associations, and businesses. We cover your employees, your funerals, pensions, children's education, and your future. Call us on 0302-267-892 or visit our website www.allianz-gh.com for more inquiries. Allianz Life, we secure your future.
Wow, wow, wow. Hope you have heard, rent to own now in Ghana. The Flan City Extension Project rent to own land and house ownership scheme by the Ningo Pram Pram District Assembly and its partners, supported by the Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development and the UN Habitat, are right here in Ghana. So be smart, because where you trade and live really matters. Apply now and own a home or a fully serviced land. Wait a minute, don't forget to join our affiliate housing cooperatives also. Special offers last up to October 31st, 2021. Call us on 055-55-3300 or 0577-911101 and 055-7054-635. Website newaccra.city. Plant City Extension Project, shaping Ghana's urban future.
Joy 99.7 FM.
You're welcome back to Business on Newsnight. Now, Finance Minister Ken Ofori-Atta has described Ghana's removal from the list of countries with deficiencies in anti-money laundering laws as a confidence booster for the economy. The Financial Action Task Force last week took Ghana on the list of countries that don't have the laws in place to check money laundering. Now, this is due to some progress made. But speaking at a news conference in Accra, the minister noted that government to do everything to ensure that Ghana's exit is safeguarded.
The Ministry of Finance, Bank of Ghana, and the Ghana Revenue Authority would ensure that adequate and sustainable resources are deployed to ensure the integrity of the AML-CFT regime in Ghana. We also stand ready to support our neighboring countries who will soon be going through mutual evaluation. With these achieved, Ghana will be applying to be members of the FATF organization, which would right now, only South Africa is a member from Africa of the 39 members, and we would hopefully be the second.
Finance Minister Ken Ovoriata. Meanwhile, financial institutions and banks may have to wait after August or September this year before their transactions will not be subjected to any scrutiny. Now, this is because the European Union is now looking at that time to remove Ghana off its list. Now, the Bank of Ghana has indicated that plans to introduce a digital currency would aid efforts to go cashless as a country. The central bank digital currency will be more of a digital version of the Ghana Cedi. The process is currently ongoing to ensure that they establish whether government can indeed go ahead together with the bank to issue the currency. It is also looking at a situation where to aid efforts to fully go cashless by government. Let's hear from Elsie Awaji. She is second deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana.
Many central banks around the world have launched this, the first being the Bahamas. Many others are exploring it, and we have launched a pilot to see whether we can have a digital currency, which the central bank would issue, and then, you know, the banking sector and everyone would use that currency. And we believe that that holds a lot of promise for a cashless society going forward. It's still very early days yet. We have made our intentions known. There's a lot of work that is being done currently. Study the area and see the feasibility of it for Ghana. And at the appropriate time, we'll be able to announce what our findings are.
Elsie Adoawaji is the second deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana. The Securities and Exchange Commission has warned that it will take strict action against media houses for advertising non-licensed financial investment firms in the country. Now, this is part of measures by SEC to clean up the market and protect customers from scams. Head of Legal and Enforcement at the Securities and Exchange Commission, Sally Asbiri, disclosed this in an interaction with some journalists in Accra.
Discusses advertisements. It gives the SEC some roles to play when it comes to advertising or publishing notices to the public on TV, radio, all kinds of platforms. Now, if you look at 144, the title is Advertisements and Protection of Consumers of Financial Services. So this is clearly targeted at protecting people who are watching adverts, and these adverts are about financial services. This section is a broad section.
The interaction is part of several engagements between the Securities and Exchange Commission will be embarking on to engage the public and educate them on their mandate as well as protect them from other scams in the investment space. Now, MTN has announced that it plans to invest in some $1.49 million in network expansion to aid the transformation into a whole digital company. Chief Executive Selma Dadivo said this will improve its services to meet the rising demand of customers.
And the recognition that we now live in a global village, MSMEs in Ghana can no longer only focus on their immediate geography, but are required to adapt and scale to be competitive in markets outside our borders. In view of that, we're launching an SME campaign to create more awareness on how small businesses can use the power of technology to enhance the management of their business. Being fully aware of the enormity of the accelerated digitization, we're investing a total of $149 million in network expansion and modernization this year to meet the demand for digital services from customers, from consumers, and from MSMEs.
Selma Dadivo is Chief Executive of MTN Ghana. Now, Coca-Cola Bottling Company is donating 10 pesos from every bottle purchased of its 1.5-liter bottle of Coca-Cola, Fanta, or Sprite to support the COVID-19 private sector fund. The company says this is part of efforts to support government in fighting against the coronavirus. Corporate Affairs Director for West African Business Unit of Coca-Cola Bottling Company, Bethel Yeboa, announced this after the company presented some 373,000 cedis to the fund.
Besides all the other things we are doing to
and I support government's effort at addressing the issue of the COVID. We are also saying to the Ghana private sector in our COVID fund that with every 1.5 liter in our PET bottles, whether it's Coke, Fanta, Sprite, that any consumer in our patronizes or buys, we are committing to remit 10 pesos to the fund. And we believe this is investing in consumer health and our customers. And we also believe that this also aligns strongly with the effort of addressing the issue of the COVID. So we started this last year, September, and it was supposed to have ended this month of June, but we have extended the period that we would be donating to the fund to the end of the year.
Corporate Affairs Director for West African Business Unit of Coca-Cola Bottling Company, Bethel Yeboah. To the stock market, if you have invested from the beginning of this year to now, you've made a return of 36.16%. And also, if we restrict ourselves to the financial stocks, you made some 4.97%. Now, all these investments put together is more than what you get on your savings account, your treasury bills account, as well as other investments on the market. And that's all for business news on Newsnight. Back to you, Evans, and Emefa.
Thank you very much, George. So let's get into your messages that you've sent via WhatsApp. There's one here that says that there's traffic at SEC Junction, close to the West Hill Mall. Confusion everywhere. Cars are not moving. They're asking for help.
Okay. And Adam says, while we condemn the use of live bullets by the army and police at Ijra, we must equally condemn the unruly behavior of the irate protesters. It is complete foolhardy to charge on the police and even attempt to attack them in such a volatile situation. Abuchi Philip from Keta says, those who killed the late Muhammad Ibrahim, a.k.a. Kaka, they will face the law. The IGP must step down.
And we have one from Citizen Sika Togo says, I'm of the view that such reckless and irresponsible acts of unprovoked violence on citizens by security forces is disturbing and distasteful for our democracy. Oscar Bedra from Ho says, we now live in a country of insecurity and injustice. How on earth could the brother of a slain social media activist be arrested? We are fast losing trust, he says. And Shem Mixin Yeboah, he says he's a former military man, so he's a veteran. It's quite clear to see our security deployment to such civil activities as very bizarre. No crowd dispersal tactics initiated is his question. It's very sad. Ghana, God's own Ghana, deserves better, he says. Wilson says, the recent insecurity and economic hardship in Ghana are signs of lack of leadership.
Nana Ekwama says, nothing can justify this barbaric act of military personnel. Couldn't they have done better than shooting into the crowd? Joe Mentz from Ashoman, when I listen to some of these ministers, I wonder how much they know about their respective ministerial portfolios. Sammy says, Honorable Idrisu and his minority side should save their breaths, calling on the president to set up Seoul commissioner to investigate the dastardly shooting into unarmed demonstrating crowd at Ijra by the military and police officers. It will amount to a waste of state resources, just as Abel Short's finding on the Yawaso West Wagon was not implemented.
Okay, let's go on to some stories now. Tonight, NDC Jomro, Member of Parliament, Dorcas Afotofe, is challenging a Sekendi High Court order for her to produce a renunciation certificate of her Ivorian citizenship within 10 days. So with less than 24 hours to the deadline given by the court, lawyers for the MP have filed an appeal at the court in Accra, arguing that the judge erred in making that particular or giving that particular order. The Jomro MP's eligibility has been challenged, that she holds multiple citizenship, which bars her from contesting for the position of an MP. My colleague Maxwell Agbagba has been following this. He joins us in studio. Maxwell, you have details of that appeal. Yeah. What are her reasons?
Well, on the grounds of appeal, one, she says the ruling of the High Court is against the weight of the affidavit evidenced. Two, the High Court erred in law when it made the order to produce for inspection and copying the renunciation certificate of her Ivorian citizenship or any document evidencing renunciation of her Ivorian citizenship. It goes on to say that the High Court judge wrongly exercised its discretion in ordering the appellant to produce the certificate of renunciation of Ivorian citizenship or any document evidencing renunciation of Ivorian citizenship when the petitioner failed to establish the necessary for the production of a certificate of renunciation of a citizenship or document evidencing renunciation of citizenship. Mm. Now, last one, it says the High Court judge, in ordering the appellant to produce a certificate of renunciation of Ivorian citizenship or any document evidencing such, wrongly shifted the burden of proof from the petitioner to the first respondent.
So she has a plea to the appeals court. What
exactly? Yes. So in the reliefs, one, she's seeking a declaration that the order to produce for inspection of the renunciation certificate of allegiance or Ivorian citizenship or any document documenting as such is erroneous and has no legal basis. Two, an order setting aside the order to produce for inspection and copying of the renunciation certificate. And then thirdly, any further or other orders as the Honourable Court may deem fit.
Okay, but you've been interacting to the NDC's Director of Communication for the region. What has he been telling
you? Yes, there? Richard Keck Mensah. He said they were very meticulous even at the stage of the primaries. They dotted their I's and crossed their T's. So they are very confident that this case will fail in court and that she can. In fact, she has the renunciation certificate.
Mm. And I think the appeal court will give us a fair ruling. After that, and if anybody wants to challenge, they can come to me. I will show them the document. We have it. There's no cause for alarm. And I want to entreat all NDC party people listening to me all over the world that there is no cause for alarm. The NDC parliamentary, the then parliamentary candidate and now the member of parliament for Jomoro is only a citizen of Ghana, and there's no cause for alarm. We should be rest assured that seat is for NDC and we'll continue to hold it. And on the issue that whether the woman has the renunciation certificate or not, we have it, but we are talking about law. We are not talking about emotions here. We have the document, but we think that the processes of our judicial trial should be fair to us, irrespective of the political coloration. And we think that the judge didn't do good work for us. We are in disagreement with his judgment. That is why we are appealing. But for the document, NDC is not a small party. It's not a wayside political party that anybody at all can just come and file and contest election and win parliamentary elections without we going through certain basic things. We are a very grassroots party, and our ears are on the ground. And as a region, before she came even to vetting, this issue had already started piling up from the opposition MP when they got to know that this woman is the only woman who can win the seat for NDC. So they started peddling that falsehood among we, even the NDC, so that there will be apathy against her and vote against her during the primaries. But we overcame that because we went into the matter and we have evidence that she has already renounced a document far even before the NDC primaries.
Well, it's time for sports now, and Hans Mensando is here. Been enjoying your commentary.
Nice shoes.
Where's the shoes?
Thank you very much. What shoe are you talking about?
No, not your shoes.
You're talking about Emefa Apawu.
Yes.
Am I wearing shoes?
Oh, okay.
What's your obsession
you
with
mean
my shoes?
That
though?
Shoe.
Nine shoes.
Give me this.
Just say thank you and let's.
I wish the cameras can pan to her legs.
Nobody so won't. Now, this Royal Committee of the Ghana Football Association has placed a 5-year ban from all football related activities on the Chief Executive Officer of Kumasi Asante Kotoko, Nanaya Mponsa, for more Ghana FA competitions. The decision from the DC said the decision to withdraw from all GFA competitions was a breach of the FA's regulations. And must be stated that withdrawal from a club from all competitions is not a light-hearted matter for a reason that a club is defunct. The consequence of a club being defunct and a board resolution to withdraw from all competitions must not be lost on anyone in association football. And Nanaya Mponsa, who is a majority shareholder of FAR Rangers, will join other directors of the club to serve the 5-year ban. Very interesting what happens in respect of his association with Kumasi Asante Kotoko. And for you Manchester United fans out there, Jadon Sancho and has signed for Manchester United. We understand that a deal worth about 90 million euros has been agreed between Manchester United and Borussia Dortmund. The only thing that remains, Evans, is a medical, so and this has been confirmed by the one man, the one source that we all trust when it comes to transfers in world football, Fabrizio Romano Evans.
Oh, thank you very much, Hans. We'll see how...
You're excited?
Here we do.
Oh, not really. I mean, Manchester United supporters are really not Sancho, you know, intoxicated. We don't think we need Sancho.
Which player would really, you know, get you off your seat, make you so excited?
If we had bought Haaland or Kane, definitely.
What about Cristiano Ronaldo?
No, it's a sentimental value, really. He's coming back home. Okay. But that would just not be a big deal. But definitely those two players.
You've got Sancho.
Yeah, it's okay. We'll take it like that. There's, you know, 90 million that we can spend. The richest club in the world. It's okay.
Let's come back home and clean Accra.
Let's do so, because the environmental health inspectors of the Accra Metropolitan Assembly, they've ordered meat sellers at MFS favorite meat joints at the London market here in Accra to immediately undergo medical screening. Did you know that they didn't have that?
I'm surprised. 350 of them, they did not have those medical certificates. Well, in addition, almost all the sellers at the poorly ventilated meat shop had no face mask on when the team got there. There's more in this report put together by Manuel Cranting.
Last week, we were at the slaughterhouse at Aveno. Well, after the slaughtering is done, well, it enters the meat market, and this is where we're going to inspect today.
My name is Sule Dalad.
Sule.
Dalad.
Dalad.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Sule Dalad, are you the head of the slaughterhouse, the meat shop here?
Yeah.
Okay. I want to find out, how many workers do you have in this particular meat shop?
I get about more than 350.
350, roughly, yeah, roughly almost 400.
Yeah.
I would like to see your AMA health certificate. And that certificate will be your guarantee and your document certifying that you are healthy to handle food for public consumption.
You get problem about that card. Everybody to come and do the thing, because for that matter, some people, they know they do. I tell them, say, if you finish, do the card, they will come around. Has the one you know do, I tell them, say, if the one you know do, therefore take and go court. I tell them.
And look at the condition here. Does it fit you?
Do that.
When you wake up this morning, you brush your teeth.
Yeah.
You bath. So this shop is the same thing like you yourself standing here. So every day, when this is the second phase of the meat shop. So all these people are part of you people.
Exactly. Yeah, we used to sell only the eggs.
Only the
head. Uh-huh. Then in the intestine, because of the water.
For all of you operating here, nobody has any health certificate. You don't?
Health certificate.
Can I see yours?
The health certificate.
Can I see yours?
It has expired.
Yeah, yes. Oh, no, no. You say you have it. Look at this. This is 2015.
Mm-hmm.
It's expired.
This one is a new car. No,
no, but look at the time you did it. 2015.
Some of them are expired already. No.
Because they,
after today's exercise,
exactly.
All of you, we are going to subject you to screening. And we are going to ensure that this your room, you yourself, provide roofing sheet and roof the place and tidy the place.
We will do it.
Let him look neat. We will come here within a week.
We will do it.
If we come and you don't do it,
and that's why Joy Clean Ghana campaign. Mm. As Sitanga, you can't go wrong with him. Mm. Emmanuel Cranting.
You know the report. Lesson there for me.
I'm a vegetarian now.
okay. Next time when you go to buy your meat, ask to see their
are you kidding?
Health certificate. Yeah, you might as well. Ask them, what is your health certificate?
At the London market.
Yes, yeah, the London market.
Oh, have you gone to buy meat from there before?
Do you know
the men who sell the meat? You ask them, let me see your certificate. I'm a call certificate here, Danny Mahi. Yeah. Okay, all right. Mm. I'll go with you. Then you ask them.
Well.
It's time for Strong and Sassy. Gifty and up here. Yeah, here on that. Gifty, what are we talking about?
So our topic tonight is the choosiest of beggars, but we're just focusing. Yes, I know. we're just really focusing it on, you know, the decision you make when you have to marry, you know, like wedding. Oh. Or
did you have a big wedding, Evans?
I'll come to Evans. But, you know, we're making the conversation more like, just because you don't have money doesn't mean you can't be choosy versus cutting your coat according to your fabric.
So where kind of you, conversation. Where would you get it from?
We should ask you, Emefa, would you rather spend the money because you have it, or you'd rather
have a life ahead? I want a small wedding. In fact, just my mother, my father, and we just sign and we're gone.
Wow. That's a 5,000 kind of wedding.
I want a big car. I want a big car, so let's focus on that.
Okay.
You come and eat and tell me that the food was not even nice.
Okay.
So don't come.
But for people, it's a one-day event that should speak well of you.
The marriage should last longer than the wedding.
Okay. Why is everyone quiet?
Oh, because I spent 5,000 CDs on my wedding.
Oh, okay. That's good.
Yeah, I mean, rented everything, including the gown. 2013.
Good.
And we rented the gown. Rented my suit.
I'll never rent a gown.
Well, that's you. I mean,
what would you need it for? After,
I mean,
though?
I mean,
then don't buy one. I mean, don't rent one. Just do a slit and cover and move on.
Oh, okay.
That's also good. But yeah. that you spend a lot of money in buying slit and cover and sewing and paying rent. Well, what, 200 CD or
we
something.
Need to wait for Strong and Sassy, choosiest of beggars. Right. We'll hear the views. Gifty, yes. We'll be waiting. That's it for Newsnight. I am Emefa Apawu.
My name is Evan Spence. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
I used to bite my tongue and hold my breath, scared to rock the beat.